Hello and welcome. My name is Jonathan Vita, and we're going to be looking at Harry Frankfurt and his article on the moral responsibility and how it relates to the principle of alternative possibilities. Now, the overview of what we're going to be covering thus far. First, we're going to talk about the principle of alternative possibilities, namely that you're morally responsible only if you have additional options than what you in fact choose. Then we're going to look at the a variety of different cases that he thinks we can be morally responsible for, but we don't have other options. And these are named after him. They're now called Frankfurt-style cases. But then we're going to look at moral responsibility and just try to give a deeper account of what kind of matters in order for us to be morally responsible. So the principle of alternative possibilities. This basically states just a very simple claim that any agent is morally responsible only if there are alternative options. That is, that there were alternative actions that one could perform. Now, when we're talking about agent, we just mean like a common case, like I'm an actor in a some kind of action. Like if I choose to go to the store, I'm the agent in making a purchase or a transaction. So an agent, somebody who's acting, who's causing something to happen, that kind of individual is morally responsible only if there were alternative actions one could perform. Now, the motivation behind this is manifold, and it seems pretty intuitive, right? Is that, like, if you do something wrong, it seems like the only reason we would be able to hold you accountable is if you chose that one over something else. You chose this instead of something else. It's because you made the difference. It's because you chose one action that you preferred, that you wanted to happen or something like that, over something else. So if you've got a bunch of options, some are good, some are bad. If you do the one that's bad, well, that's why we would hold you responsible, is because you could have done something that's good, but instead you did something that wasn't. So it seems like if you're going to be morally responsible, you need to have options. Likewise, if you only have one option, then why on earth would we blame you for it? It's the only thing that could happen. Your hand was forced. You may have had other options, but they were so limited that you couldn't see any other action to do. Or perhaps you literally only have one action you can do in a certain situation. Then it seems like, well, we would discount any blame that we would give you. We would also discount any praise that we would give you, because it's just like, well, you would have done it anyway. There's nothing that determined, like, you could have done differently for us to blame you or to praise you. So if there's only one option, it seems like it's inappropriate to give you credit for something or to demerit you for something that, like, you couldn't do anything otherwise. Likewise, when we think about how robots might not be morally responsible, like, one of the straightforward intuitions is that the computer is just doing whatever the programmers designed it to do. It did this action because a script determined this is what they ought to do. So if you're going to be morally responsible, it sounds like you have to be able to do something that a robot can't. Namely, that you got to have several choices and that you determine it, not somebody else, like a programmer or a script or the situation that you found yourself in. So if we won't hold a robot morally responsible because their script determines one action, then why would we change the answer for you? If you are no different from a robot as far as which actions can or will occur, then, like, just for the same reason that we wouldn't hold a robot responsible, we wouldn't you either. Now, Frankfurt is trying to say the principle of alternative possibilities is wrong. It sounds good. It sounds like it makes sense. It sounds like it is intuitive. But his argument that he's going to give is that we're mistaken on this. So the principle is that an agent is morally responsible only in that one scenario. So you can imagine a variety of different cases where you are morally responsible even though there's only one thing you could or would do, no matter what. So there are going to be cases, he's trying to argue, that satisfy the condition of no alternative possibilities, yet also satisfy being morally responsible, or that satisfy the condition being morally responsible, but does not involve alternative options. So what would this look like? Well, so kind of in a very simplified way, imagine that you are in a decision and you see two different options. You're looking at like a dish of cheesecake, or you're looking at a steaming pile of carrots. You see these two options, and it looks like there's a choice to be made here, right? And the choice is obvious: go for the cheesecake. But if you only choose one, so much so that you don't ever choose the other, it seems like there's like less of what we would consider to be freedom. It seems like even if there are two options, and there are going to be cases where you cannot or will never choose the other option. So what's really going on is it looks like there are two options, but really there's one and only one, and there's another that looks like it's an open option, but it's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. You might even put a stronger claim: it could never occur in those circumstances. Now, is this going to satisfy our intuitions? Well, maybe he can give us some cases where you see options, but even if it's impossible for you to do otherwise, that is, you will only be able to do one option, you're still morally responsible. So here is the scenario. So see if we can come up with any kind of situation like this, one that fits this definition. Any situation where you could not do otherwise, but you're still morally responsible for your actions. These are going to be called Frankfurt-style cases. So can you come up with one? You could pause this. You could jot some ideas down. But I'm going to launch into his first one. So the first scenario is there's a voting, like there's an election coming up very soon. And since it's so close, some activists in a party are going to try to rig it. So here's the scenario. Suppose in this rather strange scenario, some activists in the Democratic Party place a microchip in a few million people so that they could hijack the decision of the voter. Now, you don't need to know exactly how they got the chip into all these different people. You just need to know this much. If you act like you're going to vote Republican, then the chip will activate and just force you to vote Democrat anyway. So they spent like all these different microchips across a wide variety of people, and they did this across millions of people, and they don't know how they normally would vote, but they do know that it's close enough that if they, you know, force even a half million, if it was like an even distribution, over to their side, that would be enough, right? So the idea here is this chip only activates in one scenario. If you are going to vote Republican, boom, it forces you to choose something else. Now, you normally vote Democrat in this scenario, and so you go to the voting booth with this chip in, and you go to vote Democrat. That's what you normally vote, and it's what you want to vote. Now, the chip didn't activate. Why? Because you weren't going to vote Republican. If it had been the case that you were going to vote Republican, it would have forced your hand. So while it seemed like there were two options, really there was just one. You're going to vote Democrat either way. If you vote Democrat, the chip doesn't activate. And if you do vote for somebody else, the chip is going to activate and force you to vote Democrat. So either path comes back to Democrat. So there's only one option then. You're voting Democrat. Now, since you did actually want to, and the chip didn't activate, then you chose the action, and you wanted to choose the action, and there weren't any other options that you could have taken. So now the question is, are you responsible for your vote? Are you responsible for your vote? You didn't have a choice to do otherwise, so did it really feel like you were making a valid election choice? Well, on the one hand, you might say no, because you need to be able to have options at the voter booth. But in this scenario, you chose exactly what you wanted. So why wouldn't we say that this is something that you should be held accountable for? If you came out and somebody said, like, did you vote Democrat? And they're on your side of the political spectrum. And you're just like, yes. And then they just be like, they want to praise you. And you're just like, yeah, that's exactly right. Because that's what I wanted to do. But then suppose they came back later and said, well, you didn't have a choice. You could have voted Republican. And then it would have forced you to be Democrat. You would just say, well, that doesn't matter. I wouldn't have voted that way anyway. So it seems like you could still be morally responsible for your actions, held accountable for your actions, your choice still be valid, even if the other options just were not alive to you. They weren't going to happen. Okay, so maybe this isn't convinced you, but maybe it has. If it hasn't, then let's consider another one that Frankfurt thinks would satisfy this condition of being morally responsible, even if you don't have other options. So the next one is of a hostile neighbor. So imagine a scenario where you are packing up. I mean, he gives a bunch of different scenarios, but imagine you're packing up to get out of the country. You've decided, you know what, I just want to move out. I want to see the world, and I'm just going to move to a different country. I've got, like, different countries in my mind and so on. And so you start packing up and so on. And little known, unbeknownst to you, there was a neighbor that you have who really, really doesn't want you here. He's been saying for years that he wants you to go home, but you never heard this. He hasn't voiced any concerns or anything. But this day, the day that you've decided to move out of your country, this guy comes up to your door, and he's been holding his tongue for years, and he finally speaks, and he says, if you don't get out of here, I'm going to kill you. You don't belong here. Get out of the country. And so you are kind of unsettled by this hostile person, and the person says, like, if you're here tomorrow, I'll kill you. Or something like that. And you go back in, a little shaken, and finish packing your bags and then drive at the time that you were planning to leave on your calendar. It seems like you chose to leave even that hour that it was your choice. It was what you wanted to do. And it sounds like, for a very similar case to the voting booth, you're responsible here too. But it seems like you didn't have a choice. It seems like even if you wanted to stay, you couldn't. Like, if you stayed, then you were going to get killed. If you stayed, then he was going to chase you out. If you stayed, then you might have to, like, get involved with the police and all these other things. But that scenario is not one you wanted anyway. You were going to leave. You were planning to leave. So it's not like you wanted that option in the first place. So you're doing what you want, and it's like the only real live option for you. So could you be held responsible for that action? Frankfurt wants to say yes. You are morally responsible, according to Frankfurt, in these cases, even though the principle of alternative possibilities is false. You can be morally responsible even if you only have one option. So the fact that there are no other options doesn't change whether you're responsible or not. Instead, something else is going to matter. Now, for scenario 1 and 2, there might be an important difference between the two. For the voting booth, there's no question of coercion here. Sure, your actions are in some respect open to being hijacked. At least in the second scenario, there might be the important difference because, like, whereas in the first one, you're just choosing your normal vote. In the second one, you have to change some of your life, and it might be due to one of two reasons. The first reason that you might get for leaving the country is that you just wanted to leave, and you were just planning to do that. That might be your reason to leave when you actually go. But if you are now responding to your neighbor's threat, now coercion is actually having an influence on your choice or your action. Now, in that scenario, it seems like now there's a little bit of a question that maybe you didn't have like full responsibility in the way that we would for the voting booth. Why? Because even if you changed your mind, you won't change your mind because of the coercive threat. Whereas in the voting booth, you could change your mind and then it would hijack. This is, you couldn't even change your mind and doing so willingly. Because if you were to change your mind, you've got the threat of coercion like right at your heart. So why exactly are you leaving? Are you choosing to leave because of your reasons, or is it now a consideration that you could get killed if you don't? If you add that additional reason, then maybe you're not morally responsible in the same way. So why would we hold you responsible? According to Frankfurt, it doesn't matter the number of alternatives. If you have one, if you have two, if you have 1,000, it doesn't make you more responsible by having more options. And fewer options don't make you less responsible. Instead, something else has to be true. You need to be, if you're held responsible, then you need to be sensitive to the right reasons. So if you're an agent, you're somebody who is acting for certain reasons, you have certain intentions and so on. Well, if that's true, like the considerations that go into your choices have to be good reasons. So we would hold you responsible if you, you know, want to hurt somebody because the reason is that you hate them, versus if you accidentally kill them. Like if you accidentally kill them, then that action is not sensitive to reasons. It could just be like your car's brakes went out or some other thing that like not in your control, but you still nevertheless hurt somebody. Like that kind of scenario, it's not sensitive to any reasons. Sure, you did it, but it wasn't voluntary. But if you are being sensitive to certain kinds of reasons, then that's something that matters. But that's also going to be true for the other side. If you're sensitive to reasons that are illegitimate, that would also undermine it. And so there is the other question, is if you are under the influence of a coercive force, some overpowering influence that some other agent is getting their will. Now, in the scenario of the voting booth, you're not under the influence of a coercive, you know, pile of activists, because they're not actually changing your decision. But in the case of the guy threatening to kill you if you don't leave the country, that might actually be a case where their will, it has an influence on your will, so much so that you couldn't even want something different. You couldn't even entertain seriously the plan to do something different. So Frankfurt thinks that these two conditions are the kinds of things that matter in holding you responsible. So as a matter of review, first we talked about the principle of alternative possibilities, namely that the principle holds you must have more than one option if you're going to be held morally responsible. Now Frankfurt wants to say that principle is false, and he tries to give a couple different cases, plenty of others, in his article, where you can be morally responsible even if you only have one live option. So instead of thinking about multiple options being what matters in moral responsibility, he thinks that you need to be sensitive to reasons, legitimate reasons, not illegitimate ones, and you need to have a will that is not being overpowered by somebody else's will.